Hey guys, welcome to my channel. If you find this video helpful, please like, comment and share. And don't forget to subscribe. Thank you. In the previous video, we have already discussed about the clinical features, genetics and some dental abnormalities, even the grading system. Now let's talk about the pathogenesis. Pathogenesis of cherubism is still not fully cleared. Previously, it was thought to be a neoplastic lesion and must be related in some way to the development of permanent teeth, thus suggesting an odontogenic origin. The theory is based on the fact that cherubism is localized in or near the tooth-bearing region. It is known as odontogenic theory. Now, the second hypothesis is the perivascular fibrosis. Here you can see the normal blood vessel and here the fibrosis or the fibrous tissue just surrounding the blood vessels, which can cause narrowing of the blood vessels. So the fibrosis that results in reduced blood supply, which leads to reduced oxygenation of bone and an alteration of the mesenchyme during bone development, has also been considered in the pathogenesis. Other causation theory include latent hyperparathyroidism and trauma, but most authors consider cherubism to be a giant cell lesion in nature. Recent studies have shown that the genetic defect characteristics of cherubism is responsible for the localized increase in osteoclasts, which cause bone resorption and responsible for the radiolucent lesion. Number of osteoclasts are normalized during puberty with a physiological increased synthesis of sexual hormones like estradiol and testosterone. That's why at puberty, the lesion begins to regress. Here, I would like to mention an important point that the biochemical findings are typically normal in patients with cherubism. It's really an important point for the competitive exams. Now, radiographic findings. Let's divide the discussion in some parts. First of all, location. Most of the time, it is bilateral and often affects both the jaws. Most commonly affected bone is mandible. And most commonly affected area, in mandible it is ramus area and in maxilla it is tuberosity area. It grows in anterior direction and in severe cases can extend almost up to the midline. Now let's discuss about the periphery. Here I am drawing a mandible. It is an occlusal view and here you can see that the periphery is well defined and some instances it is corticated. Expansion can cause marked thinning and sometimes perforation. Now internal structures, which actually resembles CGCG or central giant cell granuloma. It is a multilocular lesion, fine granular huspid trabeculi forming a prominent multilocular pattern. Occlusal films may reveal soap bubble appearance. With adulthood, the cystic areas in the jaws become re-ossified, which results in irregular patchy sclerosis. There is a classic but not specific ground glass appearance because of the small, tightly compressed tabecular pattern. As you know, that the ground glass appearance is the typical features of fibrous dysplasia and hyperparathyroidism. So, the lesion should be differentiated from that type of lesion. Now, effects on surrounding structures. Because the epicenter is in the posterior aspect of the jaws, here you can see, the teeth are displaced in anterior direction. And sometimes the lesion can cause inferior displacement of the inferior alveolar nerve canal. Sometimes teeth may be displaced or unerupted, or they may appear to be floating in the cyst-like spaces, or you can say a typical floating tooth appearance. Although conventional radiograph is helpful in the diagnosis of cherubism, Computed tomography is superior for making the diagnosis and determine the degree of severity. It may be helpful in planning surgical interventions in more severe cases. Okay, now a quick recap. In pathogenesis, according to odontogenic theory, it is related to the development of permanent tooth. Perivascular fibrosis causes narrowing of blood vessels, which eventually leads to alteration of mesenchymal cells. Even hyperparathyroidism and trauma can lead to cherubism. And lastly, genetic defect is responsible for the localized increase in osteoclast, which normalized in puberty. Biochemical findings are typically normal. Radiographically, it is bilateral. Most commonly affected areas are ramus and tuberosity. Lesion is well-defined, corticated, and thinning and perforation is also noted. Two important radiographic findings are soap bubble and ground glass appearance. It can cause anterior displacement of teeth and inferior displacement of inferior alveolar nerve canal and a typical floating tooth appearance. That's all for today. Thank you for listening, and please don't forget to subscribe. Have a nice day.